Christina Madashi Hoffman grew up along the banks of the Mystic River in Mystic, Connecticut. A longtime Austin resident, Hoffman's work has appeared in the Texas Observer and the annual anthology of the American International Poetry Festival. Through her company, Centered Light Media, Hoffman works as a marketing and editorial writer, graphic designer, and actor. Her early career adventures included antique furniture restoration and leading treks in the high Himalaya. Welcome, Christina.
Thank you all so much for coming out today. And thank you very much to Joe and Melbourne Books for having us, and for Erica and Joe and Margaret for joining in. It's really, I had a desire to have a really nicely textured hour, and I think that's proven out. So I'm going to start with a poem called I Belong. I moved to Texas about 20 years ago, and when I moved here, I hadn't been writing poetry for a while, but one of the things I said about the weather here, having come from New England, was that it's a place where you can't write poetry. It's just sunny all the time. So I'm really happy that this particular day played out like it did, because it's sort of perfect for reading poetry. This is called I Belong. I belong where there is fog in the morning along the river, where the bell buoys clang the channel's course. I belong where the grass grows knee-high in the marsh, where the egret's poise never fails to impress. I belong where masts line the waterways, where their stays beat the steady rate of the wind. I belong where the gulls call at daybreak, where broken crab shells crawl the docks as if for escape. I belong to this other place, though it would appear where I am here is also where I belong. When I moved to Austin, I flew into the old airport, which is now this gigantic development where people spend their lives. And we were just walking there yesterday. It was very strange coming from New England, this place where nothing happens. And in 20 years' time here in Austin, seeing this environment go from an airport strip to this vibrant community. And I lived really close to that area for the first number of years that I was here in Austin. And I'm going to read a poem that's about that, called Drift. I was in the old neighborhood last night. It glowed with new lights that weren't lit when I was there. I felt the weight of change settling in my heart and head. What would I do if I lived here still? How can this shift happen so swiftly in my absence? As if I'd never been standing on the corner, running in the morning by the quiet of the street, walking in the open fields, dogs unleashed and free. We couldn't do that now. A steady stream of cars flows down fresh roads, no longer ours to fill with our own voices. I'm not sure how to feel about the pace of drift in a place I once called home. So I had a quintessential Austin experience in finding my husband, Clay. I, for years, maintained that I would neither get married nor have children. And both of those things changed when I walked into the Broken Spoke one night to take myself out of dancing. But I had occasion after having my daughter. I stayed home for 2 years, and a lot longer than I anticipated. But I had occasion to question that and to wonder about it, because I always had. This is called Motherhood. Motherhood had a call I could not hear for decades. And I sometimes wonder if what I thought I heard was something other than her hushed appeal. That when I cocked my ear to listen, I mistook the wind for her voice. But then I hear a closer call from just beyond this room. And I know that after all, it's the one I'm bound to answer. So she's taught me some things. And that daughter is here. And I follow on about how when you see a kid grow, you hope that they won't ever learn to play it cool. That maybe somehow they'll just remain vulnerable and learn to live that way somehow, because we learn to play it cool. This is called hidden. With age, the effort of living is hidden. We train to mask our troubles, condition ourselves to turn our attention inward. But for the child, her energy exposed, the struggle is singular and consuming. It shows when she pulls up her socks, tries to tie up her shoes before she knows the secret of a knot, the secret to staying closed. We spend our early days in striving, then yearly lace up our minds, hope the twine holds fast, lest we reveal what is past in our learning and real in our fighting. And they give you, kids give you those moments to love, and sometimes those moments are in your pockets or in your purse. This is called the treasure. I count out the contents of my pockets filled with treasure, unearthed beneath a swing. The measure of her day, one sacred string, two magic stones, three priceless gems, and all the hopes that 5 years knows. So I've learned to shift my expectations and adjust with having a child. And I think the issue of being somewhere around 40 has come up today. This is called I'll Raise You. Let my hips flare, the flaps of my arms bear the feminine burden of rearing. Loosed by time and wear, these thighs and biceps band together to battle the model of maternity and the sexual ideal, while ultimately, gravity makes the call. I'll see your gaze, and I'll raise you one child. On that same theme, this one needs an introduction, it's called Vanity. Yesterday, I found some years tucked into the folds of my eyelids, radiating out from my temples, embedded like dimples around my mouth. I'm sure some of them fell behind my pillow into the wine glass I've drunk from so many nights. Next year, there will be one more that is not now mature enough to show its age. Oh, vanity, I thought I'd bested you. But the industry of days leaves its mark and reminds me that this is the only time there is. So I invited this trio here in part because I think the idea of committing to something, really choosing and committing to the thing that you do that makes you you takes a lot of assessment and reassessment, and you have to get yourself aligned, but you have to figure out what it is you want to do first. And my friend Sarah Bork started a 365 day photography series that she posted on Facebook, and her work is on the cover here. And she unwittingly encouraged me to write a couple of lines of verse a day. That's how this book started. And I got to see her yesterday. She has her studio open for West, which is taking place this weekend. And we ended up having a conversation about the challenge in figuring out what it is you want to do and committing to doing it, and how it seems that it changes with regularity. And you have to recommit. This is called Space and Time. How easy it is to choose to compromise. It feels like no choice at all. I never mean to put down, put away my resolve. I just leave it unattended for a minute, I think, in favor of the urgent call of laundry, cooking, making a living. And when I come back, I'm surprised that somehow nothing's been done at all. The clothes worn, the food and money gone, and a great gap where my intention might have grown. I know now that it is as urgent as any chore and ever more important to make space and time for purpose, and then give it even more. So my dad owned a Volvo station wagon, and growing up in Mystic, we would take the 10-hour drive to Youngstown, Ohio, a couple times a year, and my brother and I would get our blankets and pillows and load up the car. And usually set out pretty early in the morning, long before the sun came up, so we'd make it there at a reasonable time of the day. This is called The Way Back. Before car seats, we built forts in the way back, piled blankets and familiar pillows against the wheel wells, pressed our foreheads to the windows, and tracked the stars across the 4 a.m. sky. In the front seat, black coffee and sugar stained the stick shift while the speakers strained to carry the early news. And in the way back, sleep held sway as the miles played a low lullaby. For my dad, because he's here. It's called The Day I Played Hooky. I remember the day I played hooky from school. It was the end of seventh grade, or maybe eighth. I asked my dad, and he taught me that it wouldn't be hooky if he knew. And that meant yes, because he smiled. And I'm glad, because I couldn't tell you what I learned in class that year. I don't recall my teacher's name. But I remember well the feeling of wind on my face, bicycle wheels rolling, my best friend beside me exploring the back roads of our town, the dips and rises, unexpected vistas, open air freedom of the day I played hooky from school. And since no poetry reading is right without something that's sad, there was this, after the bombings in Paris in November 2015, there was this wonderful video that made the rounds on social media of a little boy and his father talking about the candles and flowers that were being laid out for people who had died. And it's especially cute because it's in French, if you have seen this. The boy says to his dad, "Hey, we don't know what to do now. We're going to have to leave." And they're being interviewed by a reporter, "Because it's not safe here. We have to go somewhere else." And the father says to him, "No, this is our home. Paris is our home. And we're going to stay here." And they leave the microphone on the little boy. And he says, "But I don't understand how there are mean people, and they want to hurt people, and how will we protect ourselves?" And the father says, "Well, take a look around. There are all these flowers here, and candles." And he says, "Are those for protection?" And his father says, "Yes, yeah, those are." By which, of course, he meant solidarity, among other things. This is called Paris Home. If candles and flowers, les bougies et les fleurs, could conquer fear, la peur, then I would not worry for your dreams. Tes rêves, mon amour, sweet child in the street, the boy laying flowers, the girl fighting sleep, for you both, tous les deux. I want nothing more than to wrap you up dans une couverture, to lay your head on the softest down, and give you peace, la vie, un pays, and a place called home. Taken down by a wave one time. This is about that experience, and about seeing someone who didn't seem to worry about the waves. This is called The Break. I still have a scar, and I do, a brand, from that time in the surf when I learned of its force firsthand. I stood up wondering how no one noticed I'd almost drowned. Through the break and crash, they couldn't see the scrape of bones on sand, my thirst for air. Here now I stand on shore and watch a boy ride the swells with ease effortlessly. He leans into the waves as if they've never before pulled anyone down. Though I've never blamed the sea, never shamed the ocean for its strength. Instead, it's thanks I feel. Today, this mark reminds me there is time to fear and time to learn anew. Thank you so much.